Good morning, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, distinguished ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Thank you. A reply always lets me know that I have your attention. I'd like to begin by thanking and commending Digital Dwells for this initiative. You know, over the last few years, one question that I have asked consistently when we talk about the growth potential that's coming out of Africa, and when we talk about Nigeria being the most populous one, and we speak about the potential, I've always asked, yes, the potential is there, but what about the talents to actualize that potential? Consistently, I've asked that question. I get varying answers, but then most organizations very keen on developing people. But I think that what Digital Dwells is doing and what they are going to do today by unveiling the survey is going to give us some science and at least form the basis for whatever learning interventions we're going to do. I must commend them because I think that this is the first such survey that I'm aware of that looks at learning and development across Nigeria. Similar surveys have been done in other parts, just trying to understand what are the critical factors that affect learning and development there. So I'm especially glad and appreciative of what it is that you've done, which will help all of us in our respective organizations, perhaps, I think, do a better job of the development of the talents that resides within us. So thank you, Digital Dwells. You know, the topic today is especially apt. As all of us know, over the last year or so, in Nigeria, we've been experiencing very strong headwinds economically. What with the decline in commodity prices, the currency management, forest restrictions, infrastructure, and all of that. And a lot of companies have been grappling just to stay alive. You know, what are the things they're going to do? And just by observing what has happened over the last year, I've come to a conclusion that when the going gets tough, at least from my observation of things, it appears that the training budget gets cut. You know, and I've been wondering, why that is so. I've asked myself, I've tried to answer that question. I've asked a number of chief executives, why does this happen? And then they tell me that their focus is on survival. And I think if you're focusing on survival, what should you be investing on at this time? Is it because we view the people who work for us as cost rather than as resource that should be developed in order to ensure that we do survive? But then, this is the reality that we find ourselves in today. And I think that I make the assumption I was doing earlier on, the majority of people in this room will be learning and development or HR practitioners, as well as others that are tasked with the development of people. And I think there are a number of things that we need to perhaps start to focus on, even when the going is tough there. You know, for some organizations, they look at such times as an opportunity to develop the people, since times are, you know, they're not continuing at the hectic pace, there's a bit more time, let's develop the people. But then what we see is the converse. You know, there's less and less spending that's going on there, which means that perhaps we don't fully understand what it means to have to consider people as perhaps one of the greatest capitals that we have within the organization. But anyway, I want to look at what it is that I've observed. We've also observed at the school over the last few years. We've run the school now for 25 years. I've been there for 21 years. Coincidentally, Doyin and I began our careers in management education with Modupe Afolabi as research assistants at Lagos Business School. So when you were saying you wonder where she gets her passion from, I was thinking, she began with us now. So of course, that's where she has the passion from. But anyway, you know, a number of things that we've developed, I think that there have been a number of changes that I would like to highlight. You know, 20 years ago when we joined the school, at that time, Lagos Business School was, I think, the only management development institution in Nigeria that was focused on a practical approach to developing managers. And who were the people coming and how did learning take place there? I think at that time, we probably had the generation wise, the older ones, perhaps the baby boomers there, and we're used to the traditional mode of learning as we're doing now, which is that we sit and then, you know, a conversation takes place. At Lagos Business School, we started to use case studies and things, but more or less the same. It was classroom based, learning was synchronous, and these were the people who came to the school. And that existed for a very long time. Let's contrast with what it is that I see happening now, and who are the learners, and who are the learning providers, and what's going on there. If we look at the population of Nigeria, depending on where we get the figures from, so, okay, somebody has decided to liven things up by playing some music. Okay. So if we look at the population of Nigeria, and depending, we have estimates that vary from 166 million to 180 million, regardless. What it is that's been established is that of the total population of Nigeria, 75 million are youth, what we consider millennials, people born between 1982 and 2004, which is the age range of between 12 and 35. If 75 million people in Nigeria fall into this category, my guess is that in our workplaces as well, we may slightly mirror this. In other words, we have a younger generation of workers in the workplace than we used to have before. What are the characteristics of these workers, these millennials, and then how do they expect to learn? A number of things. I think that first of all, these are the people that are digital natives that are growing up in an age in which they become very familiar, and I think a number of us in this room would also fall into that category. Very familiar with and very comfortable with technology as opposed to what used to happen before. Now, if those are the people that are coming into the workplace, perhaps we need to give some thought to say, do they learn the same way as the people who we used to have before? And if not, what has to change in the type of learning intervention that we put? I came across a 2014 Deloitte survey in which they outlined the characteristics of what they termed the modern learner. And if you permit me, I will just read a number of attributes that they came up with from also a survey from this modern learner. They describe the modern learner as impatient, easily distracted with a thirst for knowledge, overwhelmed and feeling overworked. They expect shorter learning cycles. They won't watch videos that are longer than 4 minutes. The average time they spend on a web page is 5 seconds as well. They're not interested in anything that require their attention span for several hours. This is who they describe as the modern learner. This category are the millennials. If these are the people who learn on the go, who we have in our workplace, has anything changed in our learning intervention through this period? What is it that we still expose them to? How do we intend to develop them? Because if the modern learner is impatient, wants to learn on the go, and yet the intervention that we seek is something that is at once or majorly a classroom experience without knowing what exactly is the content of that, with a short attention span there, it means that we lose them after 4 minutes. What happens the rest of the time? And therefore, if we lose them in that training intervention, how can we measure the effectiveness of the learning? One thing for us to keep in mind. And we started to observe this a few years ago in the school, and you know, I think that when the survey is unveiled today, one of the things that it begins with, at least I saw the executive summary, is that they talk about the exponential growth in knowledge. Somebody once said to me that for any engineer that's graduating today, having spent 4 years in engineering school, in another 3 years, all that knowledge will be extinct. Because knowledge is being generated exponentially. Therefore, when we think about training interventions, what are we training for? Subject-specific expertise, or perhaps are there other skills that are critical in the workplace? Several years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, I used to be the chair of the Association of African Business Schools, and we did a survey. I'm very passionate about management education, just trying to understand what are employers looking for across Africa in the managers that they seek? What sort of skills are they looking for? And overall, 3 things stood out. They're looking for creativity, problem-solving abilities, and adaptability. It was less about the subject specificity. It was more about the other attributes there. Because they recognized that, you know what, knowledge changes. Their job roles today that didn't exist 5 years ago. The job roles today that didn't exist 3 years ago. At the school, we never had a role that was called instructional design. But with the advent of technology, which is a major disruptor to the traditional models of business, we've had to think If this is the way people learn, they want to learn in bite-sized pieces, they want to learn on the go, and all we're doing is a classroom experience, then we're not, you know, being effective in whatever intervention. Therefore, we've had to create that rules and so on and so forth. So we need to perhaps give some thoughts to how people learn and what it is that we're doing. Now, it's two sides of the matter. So we have the learners on one side, and then we have the doers on the other side, all of us here in this room that have, you know, an interest in developing people. And when we talk about the development of people, what model do we use? When we look at this, an old model, which keeps on recurring, the model, the framework for learning and development, created by three professors, if I'm not mistaken, in the 80s, from the Center for Creative Leadership, just saying, how do people learn and how should we speak to those? And they came up, I make the assumption that we may be familiar with it, the 70-20-10 model, which is that 70% of what people learn, they learn from their experiences, the things that they go through. They learn on the job. 20% comes from their interaction with others, which will be through feedback mechanisms, through mentoring, through observation, and 10% come from formal learning. Therefore, if that is the case, it means that we may have to expose people to real life experiences if 70% of what they learn come from those there, because they will learn from the mistakes that they make and those things there. Okay, that may not be feasible in a lifetime. It's the reason why at the Lagos Business School we use case studies, which stimulates the real life experiences there. But if we give a thought to that and we look at the interventions that we plan for our people, what percentage is devoted to each? What are the things that we focus on? Is it predominantly on the classroom learning or the formal learning, if you like, because it may be face-to-face and it may be online as well? Or is it through this feedback mechanism as well as the mentoring, or is it what we expose them to? We need to give some thoughts to that framework. The reality, I was looking at a survey also from 2015, and I hope that the survey that will be unveiled today may perhaps speak to that, to say perhaps, you know, asking people how do they learn. And I saw that the proportions haven't changed so much. More or less about 50%, they feel that the learning still comes from all on-the-job experience. And then the next greatest proportion is from the feedback. And then the list is from the online learning as well, the face-to-face and then the formal learning as well. If that's the case, as learning and development professionals and leaders, what are we exposing our people to? How do we create an environment in which they can learn, focusing on this framework, if it holds to be true? And I hope that one of the things we'll see today will further expose us to that and see what it is that we can learn from that. Another thing I thought I would ask is whether we make the connection between the interventions that we propose and we actually put our people through and business performance. I haven't done the survey, but what I do is that frequently I ask people, how do you measure? What's the ROI on your training interventions? How do you measure? When I sit with L&D managers, they just say, oh no, we go through, you know, these are the things we've planned there. And how do you measure? Oh, well, we tick off. We've done this, we've done this, we've done this. If we tick off, we've done this, we've done this, we've done this, how do we know how effective they are? If it's a question of the skills that are there as well, everything must be linked to the business performance. So do we have a clear line of sight between the interventions that we propose and that our people go through and the business performance? Metrics like that have to be collated there to be able to see what are the expectations and what is it that, you know, we hope to get at the end there. How do we measure? And then how do we go back? And then review if necessary. Another thing is the choice of providers. Also, from asking a number of people, how do you choose there? It's always a feel-good factor. We went on this program, it was very good. When people come to the school and I ask them, oh, how are you finding a program if I run into people on the corridors or at lunch? And they tell me it's very interesting. I always say, that doesn't tell me anything. You know, being interesting means that you just enjoy being there. You know, the food is very good at the school. Come and try it out if you haven't tried it. Eh? You know, so it may be the food. Sometimes I think maybe some people think better than the teaching, eh? But I don't know, but it's good, it's equally good. Okay, so maybe when you say it's interesting, is it just interesting or is it useful? Therefore, how is it, you know, how do we measure those things? So people choose providers because it's a feel-good factor. Other times it's based on what people say, we've heard about elk school. We've heard about this, so therefore we think it's good and then we come there. But it may be worthwhile to go into the details of those and also to be able to measure. One question that we must always ask there is that if I put people through this as well, what are the expectations? That must start from your objectives. What are you trying to do? What skills are you trying? And as I made mention of earlier on, management education is still relevant. However, given what it is that I've observed also in the last 3 years or so, I think there's going to be a decoupling of management education. In other words, it's going to come to a stage where people will feel, do I have to do a full MBA? Or perhaps what I need is project management skills here now. A survey done somewhere else was looking about how those millennials that I referred to earlier on, who I believe constitute a large proportion of our workforce, learn. You know, half the time they invest in their own training. How do they learn on their job? Search engines. You know, they need something that the first thing they do is Google. I always say to people when I find that they don't do that, I say, you know what? This is my most valuable resource. If you get a task, the first thing I do is I go and check, how do I do this? As I did whilst preparing for this. That's the first thing I do. To say, okay, what does this say? Somebody has done it and has written about it. Somebody has done that research. If that's how people learn, how do we facilitate this learning, this bite-sized learning on the go? We talk about technology and how I mentioned that it's a major disruptor to things. Because up until a few years ago, everybody had to go to business school or go to a particular classroom to learn. Classroom interactions were synchronous. Whereas what used to exist with online learning was that they were asynchronous. You know, they couldn't happen in real time. But that has changed with the advent of technology. So professors all over the world can have a gathering like this and we're interacting with one another as well. Technology also enables us, when I speak about the decoupling, to give bite-sized chunks of things, of various things there, that people can choose, this is what it is that I need. What the technology for all the benefits can do is that it's not very helpful in the attitudes, the attributes, and the values. So the content, yes, it's there. But then face-to-face interaction teaches you such things as how do we persuade the other person about your point of view? How do you educate for values by the things that you do and so on and so forth? So there is room for both. Also, you know, some survey that has been conducted as well speaks about the effectiveness, which is more effective. And most times it's a blend rather than, you know, just one or the other as well. So these are things that we have to consider. I think that as learning and development professionals, a number of things that we're interested in. First of all, we should be interested in the effectiveness, increasing the effectiveness of our people, which is the reason why we say let's do that. We're also interested in shortening the time to competence. We've also seen that happen at the school. When we started 25 years ago, a typical executive program, you would come one day a week, it would last you 5 months there. So more or less, we're looking at perhaps 30 to 32 days. Now I hear managers say to me, you know what, or CEOs, please, we don't have that kind of time. 30 days of somebody away from work, shrink it, collapse it there. You know, so they don't need to spend so much time in the class. And we need to be cognizant of that. Because as I mentioned, in times of economic downturn, when there's pressures on the budget and the first thing that's going to go is training budget, you've got to be able to show the effectiveness of whatever intervention you're proposing. You want to reduce the time of time to competence of your people, all with the aim of developing a better qualified workforce there. So therefore, as we proceed today, and I think that you know the survey will actually give us a basis to understand what's going on. I hope that we've asked questions about how people learn. I hope we've asked questions as well as to what people consider useful. These are my expectations from the survey, which I think should stand us in good stead to determine what it is that we're going to do going forward as well. So I would urge us to see our role as L&D professionals more as facilitators and creators of network connections. Because if we say that the greatest learning will come from on-the-job experience, and then after that, it's from feedback and mentoring mechanisms as well, and then lastly from informal, then we need to think, how are we making this happen? If we have the millennials, as we do in our organization, you know, those people, one of the characteristics of the modern learner that I mentioned earlier on from courtesy of Deloitte from a 2014 survey is that they're impatient. So you find that we've changed from those days of lifetime employment So people wanting to live in, you know, average that a young person spends on a job is 3 years. The HR persons in my organization used to be worried when people would leave there. It took a bit for me to tell them that, you know what, let's forget about this. The only thing that we can do, you know, it's of course it's my pleasure and my delight to have somebody commit their lifetime to working with me. However, that's not the reality. It's that these people want to move on. Therefore, we have to give consideration to the fact that how do we develop these people personally and professionally so that even when they're with us, they contribute their quota. And then is there something we can do to the structure which may be outside the purview to challenge them and get them to remain? Because if they do leave, then they leave, you've lost a valuable potential that's taking all the knowledge and is going to a competitor with that same knowledge as well. They want the flexibility to be able to work. They want to work on the go. I was challenged. I think the first time I started thinking seriously about this was that I had an assistant, probably something like 4 or 3 years ago. And each time I asked her for something, it was always somewhere in one gadget. She would first bring out the iPad, then she would bring out the phone, then it's not in this one, then she would bring out things I never knew about. But it was always somewhere, anything there. She was also on one or the other. Drove me mad at first. Until I realized that, you know what, the profile has changed. Those people that we sit down there at the desk, you know, and then work money tonight, it's not that there. These people, their information is not in files, it's stored in all these gadgets there. When I asked her to do something, I asked her then to do something, and she went on the gadget. My first thought is, why are you wasting time? I expected her to be sitting down at her computer doing things, but she was actually researching. Therefore, I started to think, if this is the profile of the person who's working with me, what's the profile of the people that are coming in here? And I decided, let me go and sit in a class to take a program. So I enrolled on the chief executive program at our school. After 2 sessions, I resigned from that program. I said to my people, first of all, I'm generation Y, the old ones. If after 2 sessions, I am nearly going mad, and I am the oldest person in the class, the younger people that are coming, we need to change. And that was the start of the instructional design technology, looking at the profile of the learners, how do they learn, and trying to see how we can accommodate them. I think we need to do that. If I said to any of you here, and I hope you do have this, what are the demographics of the people that work for you? What's their profile, and how do they learn? And how has that influenced your learning interventions? I hope you will be able to tell me. So we must see ourselves as facilitators. I think the most important thing is that when we talk about L&D professionals, we also talk about the skills that are needed as well. How open are we to all these changes in the environment? Do we also have the skills to recognize what's going on there and to be able to change that? So it's not about ensuring that others have the skills. What skills are needed for us to be effective L&D professionals as well? So we need to be responsive and to change and leverage the power of the community. I think that we stretch training budgets. We need to think more strategically and think differently. Think about how to harness technology more and think about how to ensure that you're measuring the effectiveness, because that is what you will show to the executive to say, you know, the impact of this intervention, this is how it has affected business performance. This is how it has impacted ROI. Therefore, we will make a stronger case for more budgets for learning interventions than less in the time of crisis there. So I wish you a very useful deliberation today. I look forward to the report that's going to be unveiled in a few minutes, and I hope that we will all, given the 70-20-10 framework, that also one of the things that we'll benefit from here today and learn is this interaction with the rest of us there. So I wish you useful deliberations today. Thank you very much.